Alright, class, let's talk about chapter 20.
So chapter 20 is all about electric fields and forces. We kind of had a little bit of fun yesterday dealing with the static electricity. So we're going to talk about that. That was the electric force. We're also going to be talking about fields and what that is in the context of physics. Our big goal for the whole chapter is to give you an idea and understanding of electric phenomena, specifically charges, forces, fields. And this, right now, what we're talking about, you're like, why doesn't it just say electricity? And the answer is because we're not talking about electricity at this point, okay? We're talking about electrostatics, okay? Where there's just charges that are stationary, they're static. They're not moving, they're not flowing. That's electricity. That's when you get the current, and that's going to be in the next couple chapters. So one thing that we didn't do, because I don't have a faucet in here, but if you actually do rub a comb through your hair over a like a sweater or something like that, you can actually bend the water if you have a small stream, so you can try that at home. And we're going to talk about something called Coulomb's Law. As scientists, as physicists, we want to have numbers and we want to measure everything. So it's not just going to be enough to say, hey, run a comb through my hair and I can pull up the little confetti. We can actually measure what is the force that pulls that confetti up, like, and how much is it? How can we measure that? What's the value? And do all kinds of neat stuff like that. Static electricity is just a small version of the same thing that goes on with lightning. So, or I say static electricity, electrostatics and things like that. So we'll talk about the electric field and how it gets to be strong enough to ionize the air and switch everything around. So this is used in all sorts of things, even smoke detectors and stuff. That's how they figure out that there's smoke in the air. All right, just a reminder, we talked about vectors. I think we might talk, we're not gonna talk about vectors today, but we will throughout the chapter. All right, so charges and forces. These are the big ideas that we're going to come across today. So charges, the electric force, which is a new force for us, insulators, conductors, and this process called polarization, which you saw yesterday, though we didn't really give it the name, polarization. So this is a new force. When we talk about the electric force, this is a new force. And there's only going to be these forces, that's it. If you look up there on the poster, we've got the spring force, the drag force, tension, normal, friction, weight, thrust, which we don't deal with too much, and the electric force. That's it for our class. If we were going to more, I'd say advanced, but just, you know, going deeper into physics, we'd also talk about the magnetic force. We're not talking about that. And then a lot of those you can break down into their the fundamental forces that are going on between molecules and stuff like that. But that's everything that we're dealing with. So talk to me, did y'all read about all these experiments in the book? Yeah, like experiment one, experiment two. So we'll just kind of look at the picture and see if y'all can remember what happened or what didn't happen, okay? So if you have plastic rods that haven't been rubbed, one of them that's dangling and the other one that you bring near, anybody remember what happens?
Nothing.
Okay? That's, okay, interesting, but we have to kind of have a starting point there. So nothing happens at all. Interpretation, there's nothing special going on. Okay, we'll move, and we actually call both of those in that situation neutral. This is interesting. Experiment number two, we take these plastic rods, we rub them with wool, and boom, what do we see happens? It pushes it away. Then if you do that same thing, glass rubbed with silk, now we didn't have time to do all these experiments, we had our own fun experiments, but if you rub the glass with silk, then that pushes away the glass rod. So the interpretation here is rubbing a rod somehow changes its properties, okay? So that now there's this force between them that wasn't there before. We've changed something. If we were to list all the properties of this rod, there's something else that's invisible. There's something about it that's changed that's causing those two things, that's causing this one to move and be deflected, okay? Technically, we would also say that this rod is exerting a force on this one. It's pushing back on you, but your hand is so strong that you're able to equalize it, okay? But it's not just this, because remember, look over here on this poster, Newton's third law, every force is part of a pair of forces, okay? So this rod is exerting a force on this one, this rod is exerting a force on this one, but your hand is keeping this one in place because you're super strong like that. But there's nothing to prevent this one from moving. So you're like, okay, what was the interpretation? Yeah, we call that charging. We now say that this is charged and that is charged. These glass rods are charged. And like we said yesterday, that this new force is a long-range force, and it's a repulsive force. The electric force that we're talking about is always between two objects. Gravity, we mentioned yesterday, is also a long-range force, but contrasting that with what we're seeing, gravity is always attractive. We'll see here in a second, the electric force can be repulsive and attractive. So this was experiment number three. We do a little mix and match. So you take the plastic rod rubbed with wool and the glass one with silk, and what do you know? What happens? Yeah, they attract. That's being pulled. So you're like, okay, that's interesting. That interpretation here is that whatever happened to the glass rod must be different than what happened to the plastic rod. Make sense? Because if it was the same exact thing that happened to the glass rod, then what would happen over here? It would push it away. So the fact that we get a different result tells us that this glass rod has some different property than the plastic rod. So we say, all right, this has property A, and this one has property B. Well, rather than saying A and B, we say this one is positively charged, and this one is negatively charged. We just have to have an up, down, yes, no, one, zero sort of positive, negative way of identifying the difference. Okay, and it's really kind of arbitrary. We could have said this is positive and this is negative, or this is negative and this is positive, or this is blue and this is white, and this is, you know, we could have given whatever name that we wanted to, but we just used positive and negative. So experiment number four, increased distance. How does that affect the push?
It decreases.
Yeah, it doesn't push as much, okay?
Inverse.
So two rods are held farther apart, the force between them decreases. Interpretation, just like gravity, the electric force is stronger when the objects are close. That's why when you had the comb and the rod, and you put it really close to the little confetti, then it would pull them up. But when you had the comb way up here, did the confetti jump all the way?
No.
But you had to be really close for that to be effective. That's one of the conclusions that we saw yesterday, was that this electric force is, it can be attractive, it can be repulsive, it's long range, and it's even stronger than gravity for super lightweight objects at a super close distance. Okay? So, go ahead and answer that question right there on your paper while I take attendance. Negative? What did you say?
Negative?
Oh man, y'all are so good. Actually, it could be B or C. Alright. Could be negative, right? Because y'all kind of have this thing you read through the chapter. Yeah, a positive and a negative attract. But could E be, what's the other one? C, neutral. Wait a second, this is neutral. Why is this one getting attracted to it?
Because that one is just positive, and neutral would still have some
negative.
It would have some negatives, but normally if it's neutral, I mean, they're all kind of, that means that every negative has a positive.
Mm-hmm.
Hold that thought. How could something that it was neutral, how could there be attraction there? Okay, we'll talk about it here in a bit. So, let's talk about charge diagrams just to make sure that we're not confused here. When we've got positive charge, we use pluses, negatives, we use negatives. Okay, there's actually a lot more positive or negative charges than the pluses and minus we're going to show. Okay, I mean, there's like 10 to the 20th and stuff like that. Okay, we're not going to spend the time to write all those pluses and minuses. So, that's why they say more charges represented. Now, this is a different thing. We're not writing every single charge. That's one point. Other idea, if there's more charge on something, then we're going to put more pluses or minuses. Okay? Let's keep going. This says, start with a neutral, uncharged plastic rod and a piece of wool. Rub the plastic rod with the wool, then hold the wool close to the rod. The rod is attracted here. Okay, so that's weird. What's our interpretation there? We take the cloth and rub it on here, and then we put them right next to each other, and it goes, hey, I'm going to move over this way.
Oh, because it's trying to get, it's like the things that like it took away from it.
Yeah, okay. Like, it wants the stuff back. Hey, you stole something from me. I want this back, right? So the conclusion is when did we see this sort of attraction going on in those previous experiments?
When it was opposite.
When it was the opposite. It was the glass and the plastic. So the conclusion here is we know that the plastic rod has some sort of type of charge. We'll call it negative. And this wool, because it attracts, it has to have a positive charge. And so this is get the idea that through that rubbing process, something has been transferred, okay? Something has changed. It's changed the property of the wool, it's changed the property of the plastic. So when that happens, not only when you the rod is rubbed by the wool, not only does the plastic acquire a negative charge, the wool acquires a positive charge because of what Emily was saying. The charge is transferred. It wants back whatever it lost, okay? In general, this is what we say. A neutral object contains an equal amount of positive and negative charge. That's why it's neutral, because they balance each other out. So an object becomes positively charged if you've got more positive charges than negative. Negatively charged if it has more negative charge than positive. We'll talk tomorrow about how that happens, and it's kind of interesting. So there we go. So this is, if everything's neutral, we can just kind of like show them like that. But another way of showing that they're neutral would be to actually draw equal number of positive and negative charges here. Here, I think they both have 9. Here, they it has 3 positives and 3 negatives. Okay. Then when we do the rubbing here, what happens? So rub the wool on the rod. What do y'all see in this picture right down here? Yep, we see more positives than negatives here. Some of the negative charges transferred over here. And so like we said earlier, we normally don't show every single charge. We'll just kind of show like the net charge. So this one now has 6 negative charges, 3 positives. So that's 3 more minuses than pluses. 3 more negative charges. So that's why we've got the 3 here. And this is the 3 positives, showing that that's the net charge. Okay? We were not able to determine this yesterday, so you just have to kind of take our word for this. Okay, scientists have discovered that you cannot create or destroy charges. Okay, so the one of those, the wool there, the rabbit fur and stuff that we had, you can't, you know, if there's 10 trillion charges on there, and you move them all, you can transfer them to another object, but you cannot destroy them. They're always going to be transferred from one to another, okay? So the amount of charges that are in the universe right now is the same as there was 10 minutes ago, okay? Good question. It's a little bit beyond our physics class. That's almost like outside of this, if we call metaphysics, right? How did that happen? And that is a little bit beyond. You can ask me during lunch or something like that. We'll have a great discussion, philosophy about that. Great, all right? So here's the deal, though. Charge cannot be created or destroyed, only transferred, okay? There were some other conservation laws. This is the third conservation law we've talked about so far. Y'all remember some of the previous conservation laws? Conservation of?
Momentum.
Momentum. Momentum is conserved. Conservation of?
Inertia.
No, not inertia. Of energy. Conservation of energy. Energy is neither created nor destroyed. So we've got three conservation laws. Momentum, energy, and charge. Yeesh. Here's everything there on the visualizing charge handout. Let's go to the next page. So now we talk about insulators and conductors. So we've got experiment number 6. I'm glad they're doing all these experiments. They say charge a plastic rod by rubbing it with wool. Touch a neutral metal sphere with the rubbed area of the rod. The metal sphere will then repel a charged hanging plastic rod, which I don't think we're showing right here. But if you take this and touch the metal, and then you have another plastic rod here, then it will now repel it in the same way that this charged rod did. And the idea then is, whatever the property that was this charged plastic rod had, that property has now transferred to the metal, okay? And so we're like, okay, that's interesting. Just by touching, apparently, we didn't have to rub it like with the wool and everything like that. So, where's our interpretation? Oh, there's no interpretation. The metal sphere appears to have acquired a charge of the same sign as the plastic rod. So if this was negatively charged, now you touch it, now the metal is negatively charged. Okay, then we have this kind of weird setup where we have two metal spheres and a plastic rod between them. And you do that same sort of experiment. You charge the plastic rod and you touch the metal on this one, okay? This sphere acquires the charge, but this one over here doesn't. So if we brought a hanging plastic rod here after we did the transfer here, then that metal plastic rod will be deflected, but we brought it over on this side, nothing. What's the conclusion there? What can we conclude? What does that tell us? Yeah, this plastic rod right here between the two metal spheres does not transfer the charge. We go from here to here and we touch it, this now it becomes charged. But even though these two are connected via this plastic rod, this one over here does not become charged. Now, it's kind of almost an obvious answer because y'all are pretty well versed in the language of insulators and conductors, right? Plastic is an
insulator
and metal is the conductor, okay? But like I said, we're assuming you know nothing about this. Okay, so, all right. Interestingly enough, we put a metal rod between those two. Then what happens? They both become charged. Right. So if we then bring a dangling plastic rod here, it will be deflected. And then if we brought it over here, it would also be deflected. Okay. So here are the conclusions. There, charge can be transferred from one other to another only when they touch. Discharging is what we call the removing of charge from an object. Conductors are those materials through or along which charge easily moves. Now, we've not even actually discussed what the heck is charge, okay? Just, it's either positive or negative, that's all you are. Now, y'all know what carries charge, like what's positive and what's negative. Y'all know? It's in the section. Kevin knows, he read the rest of the chapter.
I do. No. Remember.
Gracie, you got a guess? What carries charge? What's that?
I'll say electricity.
Okay, so what is electricity?
I'm thinking this is physics. I'm thinking of physics, but it is.
It is physics, right. Does anybody know what actually is
polarization?
And that's a force. I'm looking for the thing. What is the thing that's moving? I don't expect you to know because you haven't read the next chapter. Maybe.
Things moving.
There are things moving. There are electrons, yes.
Atoms moving really fast.
Atoms moving really fast.
Or it's like the reactions between atoms.
And
I don't know.
Yeah. Okay. See, that's what we got to talk about tomorrow. Tomorrow is how all of this, how charges relate to the atom. Y'all know what the parts of the atom are, right?
Yes.
What are the parts of the atom?
Proton, neutron, electron.
Yeah, that's what we're talking about tomorrow. how all this stuff about charge is connected with that, okay? Because we're all like, yeah, I know, this one's charged, and then it goes to here, and then it goes through here. Okay, but the question is, what is going through there? Is it protons? Is it neutrons? Is it electrons? Is it something else? Do you see what I'm saying? Like, what is actually moving? We're actually at a very high level of discussion. We're just talking about charge. This one is positive, and now all of this stuff becomes positive because it transfers, okay? Tomorrow we'll talk about what the actual thing is moving. By the way, I'll tell you, it's all electrons. There it is. It's electrons moving. Mm-hmm. The protons don't move, sorry.
And then the element would change.
Spoiler alert, right? Yeah, protons don't move.
Right.
If you have protons moving, then you have a nuclear bomb.
Yeah, problems.
Okay, so yeah, there's going to be issues. So it's electrons are awesome. They move around. Insulators are the stuff where charge cannot change, cannot move, or at least can't move very easily. Okay, hint. Insulators don't allow electrons to move through them very easily. Okay, we've got some nice pictures we'll see tomorrow. Glass, plastics are insulators. Metal is a conductor. Okay? All right, electrostatic equilibrium is a big, you know, mouthful of a word. It just means that the charges are at equilibrium, totally balanced, okay? And the charges are not moving, okay? Let's see here. I think you'll have this problem.
Yes.
Okay. Consider two objects, A and B. Object A has a net charge, while B is uncharged. Based on this information, it must be true that A is a conductor and B is an insulator. A is an insulator, B is a conductor. They're both insulators, they're both conductors, or there's not enough information. Now here it says, A has a net charge and B is uncharged. What does that mean? Let's just talk about A. It has a net charge. What do y'all think? Does that mean it's a conductor or insulator?
Uncharged?
It says net charge. So that means it's either positively charged or it's negatively charged. Does that mean it's a conductor? Or does that mean it's an insulator? Or can't tell?
The plastic rod that was used to charge the metal balls. It was the same as the plastic rod in the mill, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it was charged.
It was charged. The plastic thing was charged.
So you could,
but it was an insulator.
But it was an insulator, but it could also be a
exactly.
Yeah.
I don't think there's enough.
That is correct. There is not enough information. Just to say something's charged or uncharged doesn't mean that it's a conductor and insulator. You can have conductors that are charged or not charged. You can have insulators that are charged or not charged. Just like she was saying, like the rod and the plastic comb. Okay? Okay, so let's talk about this charge polarization. This is back to that first question at the beginning. How could something that's neutral have an attractive force going on? How do we pick up those pieces of paper? Those pieces of paper weren't magnetic. They weren't metal, right? Why were they lifting up? Well, this is how it happens, right? You bring a positively charged or negative, this example here is positively charged rod over here. Now, this neutral sphere is in fact neutral. It has an equal amount of positive and negative charges, okay? Same number of electrons and protons, okay? But as you bring this positive charge over here, we discussed that positive charges repel, a positive and negatives will attract. So as you bring it over, you can think of it like this. The positive charges are like, hey, get us out of here. There's a positive charge rod coming here. Get over here, get away. And they all run down over here, scared, okay? And the negative charges are like, woohoo, hey, there's positive rod over there, let's go. So they're kind of going over here, and there's a little bit of a shift within this neutral sphere that it becomes a little bit more negative on this side and a little bit more positive over here on that side, okay? And as a result, the ball or the sphere here feels an attractive force being pulled this way. Now, it's really being pulled this way by those negative charges. At the same time, these positive charges are pulling it away. Now, the question is, why does the negative charges are pulling it this way, towards the rod. The positive charges are pulling it this way, away from the rod. Why is it that the ball actually moves closer to the rod? Why did that piece of paper yesterday jump up to the cone? or the bead follow the magic wand?
Is it because there's more protons in the rod than there?
Nope, that has nothing to do with the rod. Do you understand the question? Question is, the negatives are pulling it this way, the positives are pulling it this way. Why did the negatives win? And we see this thing go, whoop.
Because they're stronger?
They are not stronger. They are, the charge between a positive, or the force between a positive and a negative charge, okay, is, so these guys are going to be pulled this way. This guy here will be pulled at, 0.1 newtons.
Oh.
A positive and a positive charge pushes it away, make it exactly equal and opposite, at positive 1 newtons, okay? And there's the same number of negative charges here as there are down here because it was neutral.
It's because the positives are like farther away from the rod than the negatives.
Yep, that's all there is that the distance from these positives to those positives is smaller, which is why that arrow is smaller,
mm-hmm.
and the distance here between these negative charges and that the positive charge rod is closer, so we've got a larger force. So there's going to be a net force there. The fact that these are closer than these is what makes that force greater. And it's just enough of a difference that it will actually that difference is what will overcome gravity. Okay? And so this is how, if you bring a positively charged object next to a neutral object, that neutral object can be like, woohoo, going over there. It doesn't necessarily have to be positive and negative. Does that make sense? This process is called charge polarization, okay? And that force is called the polarization force. It's kind of a cool thing. Let's see what happens. Metal spheres 1 and 2 are touching. You know, before we do that, let me tell you, this is what happened with these guys over here. Or maybe you can explain it. All right, so this is metal. It's a metal wire going all the way down here. And then at the very end, there's a solid metal, and there's another guy that can kind of like freely move, okay? So at this point right now, that metal, I can touch it here, touch, you know, and I can, if there's any extra charges, it would come through me. So that sucker is now electrically neutral, okay? I charge the plastic rod, and I bring it near, and it moves, okay? Y'all see? As I bring it near, I'm not even touching it. Can y'all see? Scoot a little bit up the side so they can see. Careful, that it might slide out. So I'm bringing it near, and that little guy over there is kicking out. This is what Emily was doing yesterday. You know, it's not the wind or anything like that. I'm not going to tell you what happens. You're going to... Here's a rod, a bunch of positive charges. And then here's the metal sphere. And then it goes down. And there's another part that's also connected to it. Right there. So this thing is neutral. What happens as the positively charged rod is brought closer to this neutral object?
The positives in the neutral object are repelled.
Yeah, they're like, well, we're getting out of here, okay? So they all go down here. So there's positives here, and there's positives along this side.
Not repels.
Okay? And there's just a little hinge right here. And so it's enough positive charge, it's going to repel it, which makes this guy kick out over this way. Does that make sense? Like that. What's up here? Yeah, a bunch of negative charges. Okay?
How come it wouldn't already be like that?
Because it's neutral.
But there's...
Because every positive is matched with a negative.
So if you had, if you had more positives and then...
Yeah, initially, when this is kind of thing out there, you got positive, negative, positive, negative, positive, negative. This positive is being pushed away by this positive, but he's also being pulled this way by this negative.
Okay.
Okay, this positive, you know, this positive is being pushed away by this one, and this positive, but right next to those positive charges, there's also negative charges that are also pulling it back. So that's just kind of like hanging out there.
Okay.
Why aren't rod and the positives in the rod and the negatives in the ball thing like attracted to each other?
They are. Like why? Like, cause, yeah, I just charged this rod. Let's say it's positively charged. Yeah, these guys are one to go over there. But I'm strong enough. I'm stronger than that. Does that make sense? Yeah. If I could, I mean, if this was really lightweight, it would jump out of my hands and go, yeah, going over there. In fact, we'll discuss later on in the chapter, if I can get enough charges here, okay, then... Believe it or not, I mean, this is not a vacuum. There's actually air molecules floating around here, okay? There's an air molecule, here's an air molecule, here's an air molecule, okay? And air molecules are effectively, they're neutral, okay? They have the same amount of positive and negative charge, okay? But what you can do is if this charge right here, you can polarize the air, okay? So that this becomes positive, becomes negative over on this side and becomes positive on this side, and all these air molecules all get lined up, okay? And then you actually are able to break the bonds within the air, and these electrons go woohoo, and they fly through there, and that's when you get a spark, lightning. I mean, a spark, if you're just kind of shuffling your feet and then touching somebody or a doorknob at the cloud level, cloud to the ground, you get lightning. And you get cloud to cloud lightning too, but this is the same idea. Okay? Alright, so we'll do here. Metal spheres 1 and 2 are touching, and both are initially neutral. Three-step process. The charged rod is brought near, then the charged rod is removed, and the spheres are separated. What is the charge going to be afterwards? So I think you've got a couple of problems like this, right? All right, take about 5 minutes and answer 20.4, 20.5. I don't, for whatever reason, I've got 20.6 is marked out. I don't know why. And then 20.7. So talk about it as a team. Come up with some answers to those questions. We'll assume that you can move them without touching and still maintaining their charge property. When we move them, we'll assume that we are not changing any electrical property, charge property. So like if I move them, like if physically if you touch them, any charge on them normally will get transferred to me or any charge to me. But we'll assume that we can move them, maybe using levitation, that sound, you know, levitation technique. Well, just keep going through. Just draw a picture. Draw a picture of what happens at each one.
I kind of know why
you
might
draw
20.6
though.
But that's before they're separated. So after they're separated, now that's what I'm talking about.
I would just choose C.
What you're gonna do that is make sure you're choosing all of them. The way your odds of the guess are more correct.
So, if we all choose C.
What are y'all saying?
I just choose C.
Oh, you actually literally choose C.
Yeah, no, I
choose
there's
C
no,
for the first one.
Wait, so did I. My thought process is that charges only transfer through touch. And touch never happens.
But
through polarization.
Because look, look at this.
Well, that could be air. So that's what I'm saying. It's because you're canceling the charges and touches.
Yeah.
Okay. But then again, the polarization, if the two balls are connected, you know, the polarization is going to make all of them going to one and all of those going to the other. It's basically one object.
When
so that makes sense.
Rods rub together.
Mm-hmm. But it's saying after they're separated.
The spheres separate.
So once they're separated, do they
and
both
the
go to neutral,
one,
or do they,
one
of them stay positive?
One of them
negative?
Stays positive.
No.
And
so
the
what's
one,
the difference between the two? What? Or what's the difference between the
I
two?
I feel like one only one of them would be affected, and then the other one.
But what I mean is, if this one becomes all negative, this one becomes all positive.
Or
and then it splits.
I don't think it matters if they split.
This will, this
because something else has to touch it in order for it to lose its charge.
Okay. The answer's on the third one. So you can skip this one.
For charge by induction.
Yeah.
I think the second one.
So this one.
These are touched, and when they touch, they have to neutralize. So, one would be the middle
zero,
right?
Or zero?
All right. All right, class, let's look at this one here. We'll trace it through. Charge rod is brought near. Okay? What happens then? Tell me what I should draw. When the positive charges are here.
The positives
will go to the other side of this one, but since this sphere is connected to this sphere,
mm-hmm.
they're going to travel all the way over here. So I've got positive charges here. The negative charges are right here. Then the charge rod is removed. So that goes. Then what happens?
Oh, so then because there'd be originally positives and two, right?
Yeah, there'd be positives, negatives originally, they're neutral. When we pull that charge rod away, there's nothing to attract the negative charges here, and there's nothing to push the positive charges over here. So at that point, they all go, hey, there's a negative charge over there. And they all match up. And it goes back to neutral. Okay, so they're neutral, neutral. Then we separate it, and they're both still neutral. All right? Let me demonstrate that. Where'd that rod go? So imagine that on this electroscope here, okay, that the one bar straight down is one of the spheres, and the loose one that's kind of dangling to the side is another sphere, okay? So I kind of get this, and I rub it, and I bring it close, and they separate, but then I just pull the rod away, and they're neutral.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, this is, you didn't see that. 3.5.
Oh, I had it right. Sorry.
Oh, I flipped the two.
So metal one are they're touching. You bring the rod near, it goes over here. Then they're separated. Okay. So when you separate them, then you've got this charge over here, which has a bunch of negative charges, and this one over here, which is gonna have a bunch of positive charges. Okay. And so, even if you remove the rod at that point, this one is still going to have a negative charge. Okay?
They never got to go back to neutral before.
Yeah, they did not get it.
Because they separated.
Because we separated first. Now, yeah. I've got something that's not shown there, but I am going to try to show it to you here. I think I did it yesterday, luckily. So I have this charged, and I'm going to bring this here, and then I'm going to try to transfer that charge. There we go. I don't know if y'all can see it.
Oh, yeah.
It's, I've transferred the charge there, so now
it's not the ball, it's positive.
It's actually, they're both positive, you know, or they're both negative, whichever it happens to be. And so that's why they're being spread apart. If I touch it, I'm neutral. It actually will drain charge. It takes any extras that I have, and it goes, whoosh, 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 everything matches up since I'm neutral. Okay? Why is it going to the fall? Oh, there you go. Yes.
Told you they were.
See, they're initially charged as shells. Now hold on, real quick. This says P and Q are touched, so we've got a plus two and a minus two. So then collectively we're at plus two.
Plus two.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Yes.
Then are touched and separated. So when they're separated, what happens then? They both have a
positive. They both have positive two, negative
two. They both, so this has a plus two now, and this has a plus two.
Nah.
This would be a plus one, I would think, when you separate them.
After you do all the math, yeah. Yeah.
Plus one and plus one. Okay, then Q and R are touched together. Okay, because these are charges, you can't create or add. So if there's a positive two charge right here, okay, and then you split it, then it's got to be split one and one. Okay, so then this one and this one are touched. Okay, a plus one and a minus one.
That's neutral.
And then they're separate, so they're neutral. Then you separate it. Zero, zero. They're both neutral. Okay. Hold on, don't pack up just quite yet. We got one more thing. All sorts of circles there. Let's just to recap. There's another force, the electric force. Two kinds of charge, positive and negative. Like charges repel, opposites attract. Electric force is not magnetism. All right, electric force decreases with distance. The greater the charge is present, the greater the electric force.
Hold up.
This is the most part. This is the wrap up here, okay? Neutral objects have equal amounts. Charge can be transferred when they touch. Conductors and insulators have the different properties. And charge polarization occurs. I've got all this wrapped up here. At the end of this chapter, I'll share this up with you before you take the test. Okay? So that way you can look and see these nice little summaries. But it's also good for you to know right now. All right, that's it. Unless you're staying for a quiz.
Are you staying like lunch, Ava?
Yes.
Another restroom.
Yes.